Hi, I'm Charlie Rosemarin, and I'm a percussionist with the New World Symphony. There's almost a tradition amongst composers to swing for the fences on their fifth symphony. Repeatedly in the 20th century, you see composers making their symphony number 5 a statement piece. It's hard to explain why, but this tradition seems to have started with Beethoven's fifth. And just look at the number of iconic fifth symphonies we've had since. In addition to Beethoven's fifth, there's Prokofiev's fifth, Mahler's fifth, Shostakovich's fifth, and Sibelius's fifth. These are all masterpiece symphonies where the composer was remarkably more ambitious than they were with their fourth symphony. So, here we have Harrison's fifth symphony. I think it's important to know that there is no Harrison's first, second, third, or fourth symphony. Also notice that the word symphony is deliberately misspelled as if by someone who's only semi-literate. As subversive as Harrison's being, I think he actually is crediting Beethoven with some inspiration here. Like Beethoven 5, Harrison's Fifth Symphony takes simple rhythmic motifs and builds entire movements out of them. Harrison takes his rhythmic themes and casts them across the entire range of non-pitched percussion. He writes for small, delicate bells and triangles, as well as the deepest gongs and a gigantic thunder sheet, which is a piece of sheet metal that you strike and it sounds like a clap of thunder. Lou Harrison lived in San Francisco near two other countercultural composer friends of his, John Cage and Henry Cowell. The three of them together invented what became the modern percussion ensemble. An early proof-of-concept piece like Harrison's Fifth Symphony is experimenting with things like ensemble, texture, and sonority, but it underpins that experimentation with recognizable forms. You have three movements which go fast, slow, fast. Each movement's opening material is repeated near the end of the movement in a sort of A-B-A form. The familiar forms help to ground us in these ancient, ritualistic, and sometimes meditative spaces that Harrison creates. Please enjoy his Fifth Symphony.
Hello, Miami Beach. Hello, New World Symphony. I'm so glad to be back with you all this week with the premiere of my new piece, Danzon Luna. It's been an absolute joy and a pleasure to be working with and hearing the fellows prepare this piece this week. They really sound amazing, especially Matthew, our timpani soloist today. I can't believe it's almost been 20 years that I've had a relationship with the New World Symphony since I auditioned as the timpanist for the New World Symphony. And out of that, getting to know MTT. And when MTT called me earlier this year and asked me to write this piece for New World and for Matthew, the first thing I thought was, wow, what a great opportunity. And also I thought, wow, what am I going to do with Latin timpani? It's not something that I had ever really thought of before. Two things immediately popped into my mind that I knew I had to use instrumentation-wise. One was a Latin percussion section. You'll see in the back on the stage, there are bongos, claves, güiro, and shakers or maracas. This is kind of the core rhythmic group of this. And at the root of that are the claves, just the two wooden sticks. As many of you know, in Spanish, clave means key. And in Latin music, it also means key. Not such as in the key signature, not C major or D major, but a rhythmic key, which is just as important. And you're going to hear two versions of this that I use. One very sparingly, but there's the one you're going to hear the most of is 3-2 clave. That sounds like... That's 3-2 clave. Also, very briefly, I use 2-3 clave, which is the same, but it's reversed. So look out for that. The other sound or idea that immediately came into my head were the open string tuning of a 6-string guitar. Somehow, I don't know why, with this the idea of this piece, that sonority was important to me. So including a harp, which is a little more delicate with all these other more louder instruments, but I knew I needed to include that sonority. And then I built out the rest of the ensemble. The other instrument that's kind of featured in the ensemble is the vibraphone. And you'll hear the vibraphone hang over with these kind of suspenseful chords with the motor running, which is why it's called a vibraphone, because it creates this vibrato wah, 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 wah effect, which is very, I try to use in this piece. And then I played a couple of word games. The first word game I played was with the idea of the timbalero. In salsa music, the timbalero is a timbale soloist. In timbales, in the Latin sense of the word, somebody like Tito Puente, who was a virtuoso timbale player. But also in the classical world, timbales mean timpani or kettle drums, the way we think of them in the orchestra. So I kind of flipped the script on that. We took out the Latin version of timbales and we turned that into what you're going to see Matthew, our soloist, play kettle drums. Finally, Danzon Luna, it evokes this idea of a moon dance, which is wonderful. It's maybe a steamy night in the Caribbean. Also for me, and maybe closer to my heart, is our longtime pet, Luna, who left us earlier this year. But this piece will always remind me of the joy, the many years of joy and happiness she brought into our lives. And this piece will always remind me of that. So I really hope you enjoy the premiere of Danzon Luna with the fellows here at New World. They're doing a fantastic job. They sound amazing. And it's just been a true pleasure in this year to be able to get to work on this project with them. I hope you enjoy it. Thanks. Thank you.
Steve Reich wrote his piece Drumming in 1970. 2 years prior, he'd written a manifesto titled Music as a Gradual Process. And that title alone pretty much explains how drumming is constructed. It's a series of processes that gradually work themselves through. To listen to Steve Reich is to experience these processes. I'll detail two interesting processes which he uses in this piece. First, the piece begins with a process called a build-up, or a construction. A rhythm appears out of thin air, one note at a time. I like to imagine it as something surfacing out of water. For example, take the famous image of Atlantis rising out of the ocean. First one tower would emerge from the water, then another at a distance, until the entire city is visible. That's how this piece begins. He builds up a rhythm one note at a time in random order. In the middle of the piece, Reich writes this process in reverse, a deconstruction, and then he writes another construction. At that point in time, you might imagine Atlantis submerging, then resurfacing again. The second process is called phasing. When phasing, two players have the same rhythm and they play it in unison, repeating indefinitely. One of these players will gradually speed up while the other stays put. When the faster player has shifted exactly one note over, they decelerate and arrive in this new arrangement. This is not an easy effect for us musicians to pull off. Initially, Steve Reich assumed the effect would only be achievable with the use of machines. Normally, when another player's rhythm starts to stray from ours, our instinct is to adjust and accommodate them. But phasing asks that we stubbornly override these subtle sympathetic adjustments and embrace the resulting friction. It's been an especially fun challenge to learn to phase while socially distanced, no less. Please enjoy our performance of Steve Reich's drumming. Thank you.
Can you tell us a little bit about the piece and the journey that you've been taking them on with it?
The piece, we're calling it Chalan Number One. Now, Chalan is a very important spinal part of the body, of the rhythm repertoire in India. The other word we use for that is Farsh, which means the carpet. So you lay the carpet down, and on that you build your blocks the way you want it to appear. So the Chalan allows you to make a carpet as long in length, as wide in length as you want. And then you create spontaneously a story, a rhythm story.
So the impression I have, though, is watching you do this with the musicians is that, yes, there's the Chalan, then the story goes different lengths.
Yes.
But between you all, you also have a recognition, a kind of moment of, ah, yes, and here's where the next Chalan is, even though your narrative may go beyond that.
Yes, some may other go beyond that, but then each story ends with a punchline. So that punchline is recognized by all of us who are playing together. And then once we arrive at that punchline, there's a big smile that, oh, we've completed this one little obstacle course that we built for ourselves. Now let's go to the next one and then to the next one.
In your piece, there's an introduction. Mm-hmm. And then we go into a long section in a quicker tempo, mm-hmm. where they're going to hear a lot this motive. So tell us what that means, what that is.
When a rhythm performance is happening in India, there's usually a board instrument called sarangi.
Oh yes, I know.
That is played along. And what the job of the sarangi player is to play a melody that is of the same length as the rhythm cycle chosen. And then he plays it metronomically over and over again. Just ornaments it a little bit different just to keep the monotony not so heavy. And it's based on this word called leher. Leher means a frequency vibration mm-hmm. that floats. So the purpose of the melody is to keep the time, not only for the tabla player who's playing a solo on and improvising, but also for the audience.
And one thing that our audience is going to, of course, be hearing is there's a great deal of vocalizing mm-hmm. of these rhythmic patterns by you and even by our musicians are yes. doing some singing or vocalizing. Uh-huh. So that's a whole other very different thing for us.
The reason for that is because that is the one fixed part of the tabla repertoire in which older compositions that have been handed down pre-composed by great masters and they have this beautiful way of telling a particular happening and there's a poetry and the grammar that is so sweet, so well put together that because it's fixed, you recite it first for the audience, for its beauty, for its compositional beauty, and then you reproduce it exactly that same way. And the other reason for that is to be able to show the audience how the tabla is able to take a spoken word and be able to actually reproduce it on a dead skin.
So it's more like an expressive language. So I would play it the same way.
So what's so clear in your attitude in working with people is something which I try and do as well, which is that sometimes you talk about working with older maestros, mm-hmm. younger musicians can feel, oh my God, I can't play anything until I'm able to defend every single thing that I do.
Oh.
And of course, none of us are interested in that.
Yeah.
In a way, we would like to be involved in the beginning of the process. Let's mm-hmm. explore this together and let me suggest to you or point out to you something that
yeah.
is something you could do something with, maybe.
Exactly.
That's more fun.
That's more fun, exactly.
Anyway, again, welcome. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, and I'm very happy to be here.
Da, din, din, da, din, din, da, da, tin, tin, ta, ta, ka, din, din, da, da, din, din, da, da, din, din, da, ta, tin, tin, ta, ta, ka, din, din, da, da, din, kre, din, din, da, da, din, kre, din, din, da, tin, ta, ka, tin, kre, din, din, da, ka, te, ki, te, din, kre, din, din, da, ti, da, 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 da,
Ta ka 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 ta ka